it's true. I just asked the perfect kind of question. Now I know the way the sky gets blue.
Speaking of magic, the world's premier mushroom festival rolls into town for a fungi-filled weekend. Welcome, mushroom people. It's great to have you here. Please do not kill us. Please do not abduct us.
Oh, I'm really ripping them up here in Telluride. 3 miles over the limit. Hang on, baby. What a beautiful place, huh?
It's Larry!
Hey, Larry, glad to see you, man. Welcome to the festival.
Is it safe to eat?
You found a bunch of these together, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay, this smell is like a little bit like cucumber and a little bit like bad fish. You know, smell that and tell me what you think. I mean,
yeah,
it has a smell, you know, and notice that smell. This is a toxic mushroom.
Toxic.
This is one that you would not want to eat. If you did, you would pass water through every opening on your body, including your ears. People say, oh, well, is that a good way to lose weight? No, it's a really bad way to lose weight, actually.
Welcome, all of you, to the 27th Telluride Mushroom Festival.
We have several traditions here in Telluride. One of the ones that has been going on for a long, long time. A good friend of the festival named Christine passed away recently. But Chris used to always open the festival by ringing this big brass Tibetan bowl. And very good friend of his is here right now, and I'd like to bring him up, Robert Bouillon. And you officially open the festival with the ringing of the ball.
Think about the planet that you know. You got these continents. And not so long ago, within 100 years, I was counting, we believed those continents were always where they had been. No one ever believed that they had ever moved or could move. And now we know that not only do they move, they are moving now. And that those continents are on larger masses than the continents themselves. They're on things called plates, tectonic plates. And what I want you to think about is the Earth we know, the terrestrial part of the Earth, being underlain by a mycelial mat, a tangle of fungal threads underneath all the trees and grass and shrubs. And this fungal network decomposes organic matter, provides nutrients to the trees, and helps sustain the planet.
Coming to Telluride for the last 5 or 6 years, you know, give a little lecture, lead a foray or something, and I like to do some cooking too. I used to have a restaurant, and so I whip up some wild mushroom dishes that are just killer.
I think these hawk wings are about ready, John.
We need someone to serve. Yo, it's chow time.
There's something really cool about finding free food, you know, going out in the woods and, hey, look, you can eat that. I grew up on a Christmas tree farm. We were a little more remote, you know. So I ended up spending a lot of time roaming around the woods and hanging out in the trees and collecting mushrooms and doing that kind of stuff. Why are mushrooms fascinating? I feel like I just kind of tripped over a rock and started digging it out and found out that there was a whole mountain under there, you know. It was like once I picked the mushroom and started following it back to the tree roots and into the soil, suddenly realized it's all hooked up. It's all hooked up to the same big ecosystem. Bolivia is just amazing. I started going down there in 97, and I've been back every year the last few years, checking out the species in the upper Amazon rainforest.
Gonna machete our way through this stuff.
Look at the color of that butterfly.
In 4 days, we found like almost 300 different species of mushroom. I mean, the diversity is just incredible. And out of those, there were at least 50 that I had never seen before. There's just so much unknown in the world of mushrooms.
Look at that. Holy moly. What a monster.
Very thin flesh, very wiggly, rubbery, coming from a termite nest.
I can't seem to give them up. I just like morels too much. I like other shrooms and such, but I just like morels too much. Oyster mushrooms, mighty fine seafood, and some nice white wine. Chanterelles are tasty too, and a wild mushroom ragu. Store-bought shrooms can be a crutch, but I just like morels too much.
Well, I've always loved morels. You know, I grew up picking them. Arctic morels are incredible. Because the day goes almost 24 hours up there, you don't have the sudden drop in temperature. They just keep growing and growing and growing and growing.
First couple of pickles I've seen for a while.
Cook 'em up, fry 'em down, I like 'em when they're nice and brown. Pick all day, and when I'm done, I'll fry 'em up and eat a ton.
Every year I haul hundreds of pounds of morels down to the farmer's market. People like it.
As children, we're told to avoid wild mushrooms. In fact, I remember being warned when I was mowing the lawn not to let the lawnmower run over any kind of toadstool that was growing because it could somehow wreck the motor. Those of us in Telluride are fungophiles, people who really love mushrooms, as opposed to most people in North America who are really fungophobes. They're people who fear mushrooms. And part of it has to do with the background where we don't have the tradition of collecting mushrooms in our forests. We don't have relatives that have been collecting mushrooms over generations, as you find in Europe and in Asia. And when you ask people about mushrooms around the States and such, you find that what mushrooms they know about are the few things that are available in the markets. Sometimes they call them portobellos or crimini's, but they're all varieties of the common commercial button mushroom, which is easy and cheap to cultivate.
These are all from the warehouse. What I have is your basic white mushrooms. These in the package here, or these here. These over here are what they call crimini or brown mushroom. And of course over here we have the big ones, which are the portobellos. I was gonna get some of the more oriental type of mushrooms in, but yeah, we're gonna see how that goes.
Sleeping peacefully so they can grow and grow and grow, just grow deliciously. Then Campbell Kids will pick the best and ask the cow for cream. For Campbell's cream of mushroom soup.
The taste is just supreme.
It's nourishing too and gives you proteins, vitamins, and minerals to help you grow.
Campbell's soup, Campbell's soup, 21 kinds of Campbell's soup, lunch or dinner for breakfast too.
Soup every day makes a soup for you.
Soup tastes good and it's good for you once a day. Every day have Campbell's.
Mmm, good!
The mushroom industry has a vested interest against wild mushrooms. The reality is there are only a few really deadly mushrooms and not many more that are poisonous, so it's a matter of learning about them.
When I moved to the country, I realized that I was starved for nature. I would, day after day, drop everything and just walk in the woods looking for mushrooms. Just paying attention to anything in nature and forgetting oneself a little bit results in days that pass very quickly.
It's a spelling thing. Everybody knows guru, you know. But
what about that one too? Look at that.
These are mushroom camouflage. The mushrooms don't recognize these as boots, and so they don't hide as well. They think, what's that? It's a funny caterpillar.
This is my mushroom knife. It's cheap. I don't have to worry about losing it, and I can take it on the plane.
Eek, they got a whole convoy of SUVs. You gotta work a little harder on this carpooling.
Do you want to put anything back here, Larry?
Just this. It's a little. This is a really great thing, man. Your fly tackle.
Yeah.
A little fishing box, and I can get all kinds of species in there, you know. And they come back, and you can actually put them on the table. You put them in your pocket or bag, and your bag's like, well, this used to be. We used to be able to recognize this.
Everyone knows that mushrooms love the rain. And at this time of the year, the monsoon rains come into the mountains, creating the perfect environment for mushrooms. And with the rain heading west, it looks to be a spectacular weekend for picking mushrooms. So there you have it, mushroom lovers. Get out there and commune with the shrooms.
This is like Bolivia here. Like you're going around these hairpin curves. You're on the bus and you see sky. As he goes around the corner, you see sky, and then you see like the side wall of this, and then you see sky again. Yeah, the guy's got to have cojones the size of grapefruit to drive those buses, man.
Backdrop, Larry.
Yeah, nice, huh? But we'll be looking out here. See the edge here. We want to check the edge of this type of area for boletes, and then we'll probably go back up and look for less well-drained areas for chanterelles and stuff like that. Oh, there we go. That's some nice looking habitat there. We're gonna find good stuff all over. There's something. I think we have one of the amicosas here. If this is Agaricus amicosus, what are we gonna see?
Pink gills.
Pink gills when they're young. We definitely have pink gills. They're not gray or white, okay? Second thing is it's cuts white, stains, and then fades to this reddish orange type color. There you see the stain there again. What smell are we looking for?
Phenolic, as you described.
Right. If you've got a phenolic or library paste smell, we want to avoid that, okay? Because our toxic species tend to have that smell. What else we got?
A little honey.
Oh, good. Yep, honeys. The honey mushroom, that's a good eater. We've been eating that all weekend. They're nice and fresh and ready to go. And I see something right up there. Gonna find her. So just sing out if you find some good stuff, and we'll come take a look. You know, everyone will be spanked if they don't find a chanterelle.
A big one. These things excite me.
Whenever you got a bolete that's ripe and it's already producing spores, this sponge is not something most people are going to want to eat anyway. So I like to take those off because at least they're getting their spores out.
Ah,
you know,
that's
the fertile tissue that I just took off.
So we'll just leave that to hang around here.
And that'll stay here.
Yeah.
And now this is the other thing we often do with boletes. I often do this before I put them in my bag. Now there's all that dirt that's not going to be rubbed into your mushroom and make it impossible to clean up. So now I hardly have to wash that sucker, see? Field dressed.
Uh-huh.
And here's Laklak, Licaria lacata. The Swedish did a study of these. And they took the little thrips, the snow thrips, the little snow fleas, they call them. And they put the thrips in with all these different Petri dishes to see which ones they'd eat. Well, they came back, and these guys, the Laklaks, had eaten the thrips. The researcher says, you know, it's kind of like putting a football player in a room with a pizza, and you come back later, and the pizza ate the football player. What's up with that, you know?
I'll bring her in someday. Gonna find her. Gonna find her. Gonna find her.
Gonna find her. Gonna find her.
chanterelles, huh?
Hey,
we got a chanterelle.
There's a little one. Here we go. It's a little bigger. All right. Hopefully, if we stick that back, it'll continue to grow.
A whole handful of the little boogers.
Well, I followed your advice. I looked at the terrain, looked at the moss. Yeah. I looked for the white.
You did it right. Yeah. You got to admire your diligence on that, buddy. You never know what you might find. That's the beauty of it. Got something over there? Oh, yeah, that's a peppery boli. It's considered non-edible, but here we go. You want to try?
I guess so.
Just give you a little bit. Work it around your mouth for a second. It's not going to hurt you. It's not like a rushla. You're starting to get the heat there?
You never say for sure where truffles grow. The only way to find them is to smell them out. But it's not only the smell they like. Given half a chance, they'd swallow them down in no time.
This kitchen, this living, this dining room was designed to entertain. And you'll notice how the windows are higher over here in this section of the house. That's so the chef has a view of the mountains.
Tacos is a really strong, winey, smoky, earthy, base note type of flavor. Whereas these shrimp are going to be more of a seafood, white wine type flavor. And then the boletes are really sweet and nutty. And the chanterelles are almost fruity. So we got four pretty interesting flavors here.
Isn't that beautiful? Smell the fish. That's the mushroom I've served to people who don't like mushrooms. And 9 times out of 10, they love it because it doesn't have a mushroom taste or a mushroom texture. Very firm texture.
Pour it in there?
You bet. Yeah, baby.
That's delicious.
Ever seen the bioluminescent fungi? Those are, they glow in the dark. Yeah? There's, we have a couple up here. One of them's the jack-o'-lantern. Big clumps of mushrooms just glow. Now, you walk down the path, it's like you've got jack-o'-lanterns, pumpkins, set right out there. And we also see them down in Bolivia. The mycelium form little trails that glow, and insects will walk across. They'll find this little glowing trail, and they'll follow it right to where the mushroom is. And these mushrooms are like alive. It's like a bug disco. Terence McKenna, you know, the psychedelic guru, he had a theory that they were an alien life form, that they came from outer space somehow. All too easy to believe sometimes.
You know, I, years ago, used to hold the opinion, and still do in the privacy of my own heart, that this thing could have come from outer space, not the mushroom per se, because we have a fossil record of mushrooms and so forth, although it isn't so good, it only goes back about 40 million years. How long have mushrooms been around? Since they're primary decomposers, you'd assume they've been around since the get-go, but the fossil evidence isn't there. Well, is it possible that a very sophisticated traveling gene of viral size inserted itself into this organism for some purpose beyond our ken? Because you see, to me, the miracle of psilocybin is the hallucinations, the vision, the information. I'm completely convinced that that stuff cannot come from me. And I'm a Jungian.
Midnight before the Brujo appears. He has practiced the secret and all but forbidden rites of the sacred mushroom for decades. Rites passed on from father to son for perhaps 4,000 years. To achieve spiritual union, our scientists also must eat the mushroom. A strangely aromatic root is burned. Inhaled. The Brujo murmurs incantations in Chitina, a language unknown anywhere else on this earth. The first sound we hear as the chemical in the mushroom takes effect is laughter.
What is that?
This is mycelium with pressed with spores from some kind of magic mushroom. Oh, I like them. Want one?
Sure.
I get one with a cap. That's a good one.
Is this your first time here?
This is my first time here, yes.
And how do you like the Telluride Mushroom Fest?
It's good, man. It's great, man. I was trying to find the drums, man. but I didn't have much luck. I don't know where they migrated to, man, where they went, you know.
Terrence McKenna talks about mushrooms as having been the catalyst for human consciousness, and he has a whole theory of this, and that when we came out of the trees, we went to the dung of the ungulates and turned them over as monkeys, and they still do this today in the savannas, and they pick out the mushrooms to eat. Well, since psilocybe species is coprophilic and lives on dung, they would pick out psilocybes. It turns out, in low doses, psilocybe increases visual acuity. So in a hunter-gatherer society, if you got better eyesight, you hunt better, you're selected for advancement. So people who ate the mushrooms advanced over time. It turns out you eat more of those mushrooms, you get kind of horny. And if you get kind of horny, you have more kids. So here you are, a better hunter, having more kids. And then if you take massive doses, which of course would happen sometime, that you see God. This is why we call it entheogen. So he says human consciousness developed that way. Well, whether that's true or not, I think mushrooms have had a huge important part to play in every culture that we've dealt with. And because of the psychotropic aspect of it, many cultures use them as the ally, the spirit ally, to take them to the other world. Psilocybin mimics the effects of serotonin in the brain. It also enhances the brain's perceptual system so that users often report trails and auras around existing sources of light. But the most important effects have to do with the deeper ideas and feelings that psilocybin generates in the user. Mushrooms have what the psychologist William James has called a noetic quality. They produce profound states of knowledge and insight. The outdoors, the setting of choice for a mushroom trip, is transformed so the forest feels more like a living, breathing cathedral, a forum for the deep appreciation of nature through which the wondrous mushroom eater moves in a state of ecological grace.
I was in LA for a foray, and I was wandering around in one of the canyons looking for mushrooms. Two people came up to me and they said, do you know Gary Linkoff? And they said, well, they needed Gary Linkoff to help them find the fly agaric, Amanita muscaria, which they knew grew in that canyon. They were preparing themselves to leave the planet. And they said, well, they thought the muscaria, the fly agaric, would show them the way. They continued to talk, and I told them, you know, that's who I was. And the one guy says, listen, you have to come over to my place, and I've got something I really have to share with you. So I had the night free, and I went over. So I walked into this guy's house, and I was a little nervous because I didn't know them. And he has a refrigerator full of drugs. I mean, like, he didn't have any normal food, like no loaf of bread, you know, no butter, nothing, just drugs. And he had a couple eggs. And he had guns all over his wall. Now, I live in New York City, and that's not the sort of thing we have on our wall. We're not supposed to have handguns. Plus, there were a lot of dogs in the neighborhood barking their heads off, and they sounded angry. So this was, like, not a good scene. But he said, you're here, and you have to share this with us. So he makes up this thing with magic mushrooms, which I had not had, and I eat them, and then he sits me down on a sofa, and he says, just stare at me. And his entire living room, within a half an hour, turned from a multicolor into a kind of a desert gray. And he turned into a wolf, sitting there staring at me. He said, you look apprehensive. Is there a problem? And I said, I couldn't begin to tell you what the problem is, but I was thinking, this is the last day of my life, and this is like ending. He said, just like, let it go. And not being prepared for what was to come, I eventually relaxed. He said, do you see a light? And I said, yes. He says, what color is it? And I said, white. He said, well, are you going to follow it? I said, do I have a choice? And he said, well, that's what you should do. And then the roof opens up in over my head, and before I know it, I'm out of my body, and I'm not floating, I'm actually moving. So I follow this thing out, and we are going out into outer space, and somewhere near what he said must have been the Andromeda Galaxy, I was getting cold, and he said, well, why don't you stop by the fire? He said, well, there's a fireplace out there. Okay. So I found it and sat there. I got warm. And I kept traveling. And after I don't know how many hours, he said, do you want to come back? And I was thinking, well, you know, it's really nice out here. Why would I want to go back? But he thought it was a good idea. And so I start coming back, and reentry wasn't as difficult as I thought it would be. And there was LA, and then there was the street. And there was this one house with a big hole in its roof. And I said, that must be where I go. And I looked down, and sure enough, there I was sitting on the sofa. And it was just a matter of getting whatever it was of me out there back into that body. And that was essentially the whole night. And he wasn't a shaman. He wasn't a healer. He wasn't some kind of mystic guide. He was just a guy who was in the mountains who had this predilection for using a refrigerator full of drugs. And he had one he wanted to share with me, hoping, I think, to get me to join them to leave the planet, which I wasn't ready to do, because I wasn't sure they had a real good game plan. Now, hey, that might be an interesting thing. Could you go through a wormhole with the mushroom and find yourself on a planet like Earth? It sounds like fantasy, whatever, but as I keep telling people, yesterday's science fiction is today's science, and things that we didn't think were possible are possible. It's just a matter of partially technology, but largely imagination.
One side will make you grow taller. The other side will make you grow shorter.
One side of what?
The mushroom.
Which side will make me grow larger?
The large making side, of course.
I'll take a little of both to make sure.
You know, it's hard to think about mushrooms in a rational way, because everywhere you look, they seem to exude mystery. You look at a lawn, and you see a ring of mushrooms, and you know, we call that a fairy ring. Where does that come from? Well, the idea at night, midnight, there are fairies dancing in circles, And in the daytime, when you can't see them, there's a ring of mushrooms, which we call the fairy ring. This leads to a whole mythology about mushrooms and fairies and the little people. And this is almost like an alternate world living right along with us. Those of us who spend a lot of time with mushrooms worry about is we end up with a kind of a mycocentric view of the universe. Everything is can be explained by mushrooms or with mushrooms, so that it's hard to look at Santa Claus and not see, gee, this guy who looks like a fly agaric with these reindeer riding across the sky. Surely that must have been inspired by the use of fly agaric mushrooms and reindeer in the Arctic. And it makes sense. And then we find other things and we say, gee, it all fits together. And it can all be, the whole world can be explained by mushrooms. And all major religions can be explained by the use of mushrooms.
I'm puzzled. Are you really seriously suggesting that Jesus Christ was a mushroom?
Put pretty blankly, yes.
Surely you don't suggest that Jesus Christ and his various disciples were not human creatures.
Yes. You are dealing with a secret cult, a secret society. The stories of the New Testament contain certain incantations, certain magic names, which were really the names of the mushroom.
No, but and the writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, these men who wrote the story, you are telling me they did not exist?
No.
None of them existed?
No, it's part of mythology. It's part of mushroom mythology.
Some of the mushrooms we came across in Bolivia were like something out of science fiction. Know about cordyceps? Cordyceps are mushrooms that eat insects. The insects wander around and ingest the cordyceps, and the fungus just gradually grows right through the insect, attacking the nervous system. And when it's attacking the nervous system is when it controls the animal's movements and kind of directs it to move into a location that's more favorable for the mushroom to fruit. This infected ant climbs up higher and higher. And here, the mushroom grows right out of the back of its head. Sure glad there's no cordyceps for people, huh?
Seven young people shipwrecked on a mysterious island. What did they find? Food was scarce, and they were forbidden to eat the mushrooms that grew on the island.
Please, can't we eat the mushrooms now?
That would really be the end of us.
Can they escape the horrible mushrooms?
Go. There are mushrooms to hunt. Okay, mushrooms. Hasta la vista, baby.
The shiitake mushrooms we eat have great capabilities. They help lower blood pressure, according to a study by our National Institute of Health. Two mice with high blood pressure. The mouse on the left received water with shiitake. The one on the right, plain water for 2 weeks. They took the blood pressure of both mice. The mouse given plain water, 262. The mouse given water with shiitake, 160. That's about 100 points lower. Shiitake mushrooms are good for people with high blood pressure.
Wild mushrooms? You should cook the mushrooms.
What about just stuff we buy in the store? Slice those up raw?
You shouldn't buy anything in the store. A lot of the stuff that's in the store has been so heavily sprayed that you're dealing with contaminants that have nothing to do with mushrooms. And the commercial mushroom produces tumors. Guy that did the work, it's been published. He started doing oral feedings with lab animals, and he produced significant tumors from eating Agaricus bisporus.
I've got to check that out.
Yeah.
I'll have the Kung Pao bean curd. And do you have moor, the black mushroom? It's very wiggly, like an ear. Yeah? Do you have that? It's in the... Do you have that in the soup?
It's in the hot and sour soup.
Ah, hot and sour soup then. Okay. Yeah, yeah. We'll go for the moor, yeah.
Mm, good. Yeah. I'll try that sweet and sour combination. Larry, is that on the menu?
This is a courtesy. If you're sick, this stuff is more precious than gold. One of my favorite gigs is to give this to somebody at the farmer's market who's coming by going... I say, nasal problem, chew this. They just keep walking down the market, and before they've gone 20 feet, they're turning around going, how much? How much? What do you want for it? You know. Now, this one here, this has an interesting history. I found this one in a clear cut that had been done on private property ranch back in the 50s or 40s. They'd cut these trees. And here was this coming up, you know, 8-10 feet away from a big stump. So there's a fungal treatment right there. And then the other, this one, this Ling Chi, is cultivated. And again, it's got this staghorn, they call this a staghorn. And the reason for that is because it's grown in a low carbon dioxide environment. And it's as long as the mushroom doesn't get oxygen, it tends to keep getting longer and longer and longer. Ling Chi is repeatedly cited in the literature against things like lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, types of eczema and psoriasis, diabetes, anything that seems to be related to an autoimmune disease. Mm-hmm. This does seem to give your body a better ability to tell self from non-self, and that's a very important thing in immune response. You know, if you're gonna attack something, let's not have it part of the body. That could be counterproductive. Let's eat. I think this would make a good tip. You have some Ling Chi for...
Okay, thank you so much.
A recent study that I read said there are 485 species of mushroom that are commercially traded as medicine, but is not in American awareness right now.
Yeah.
production in Japan mostly takes place in the prefecture of Nagano, which is a mountainous region in central Japan. And a very high percentage of all the enokis in Japan are grown within a 40-mile radius of the city of Nagano. And within that circle, there is a statistically lower incidence of cancer of all kind than the rest of the Japanese population. And scientists at the Japanese National Cancer Institute attribute that to high consumption of enoki mushrooms by growers and their families. So here's a mushroom that you can get. It's in supermarkets. It's cheap. You know, its taste is uninteresting, but you know, you can get them down fairly easily. And it's one that I commonly recommend to people who have cancer or have high risks of cancer. It can't hurt, and there is good research suggesting that it is an orally active tumor-inhibiting compound.
Dave have found an old dead tree in the woods near their home. Tommy's found something that puzzles him. This hard, smooth plant is called a fungus. It grows in the old tree just as other plants grow in soil. Fungus plants like these, and others too small to see, help break down the wood of the old tree. This is part of what we mean when we say that the old tree decays. The decayed material will someday become a part of the soil, where it will furnish food for other plants to grow. Now Tommy and Dave have discovered something in the hollow end of the old tree.
These mushrooms are doing things out there, and mostly what we know they're doing is what we learned in high school, which is that they're decomposers. And one of the new things that's going on now is how people can, as they say now, proactively use mushrooms to benefit ourselves. And so we've developed something now that we call mycoremediation, and we've been using different mushrooms experimentally to find out what happens if you have an oil spill and you want to clean it up. And one of the things that's been very successful has been the use of oyster mushrooms. The same oyster mushrooms that you find in the woods, in parks, the same oyster mushrooms that you eat. These oyster mushrooms can be grown out, that is, so that the mycelium, the little microscopic threads, are in a kind of a mat, which you can put in this oil spill. And what happens is, and this has been tested a number of times in different places, the oyster mushroom consumes the oil.
Oil-eating mushrooms. It may sound like science fiction, but they're real. These are pictures of oyster mushrooms, which can be used to break down oil that's collected on mats. And that's what volunteers and some environmentalists would like to use to help get rid of some of the oil that's been collected on beaches during the past few weeks.
It's going to make a compost heap, and within 12 weeks it'll be detoxified, and it'll be non-toxic landscape-grade compost. I think San Francisco is going to revolutionize oil spill cleanup.
Two things happen when they do this. One is that you get really beautiful clusters of oyster mushrooms coming up out of this oil slick. And you'd think, well, you'd never want to eat those. But they've been tested and found to be perfectly harmless. That is, that they don't have petroleum in their cells. They are clean, as it were. The other is, and the more important one for the environment, is that the area is clean. There's no residue there. No remnant of the oil spill. And this opens up the possibilities for not just oil spills, but what about areas that have been polluted from dump sites of various kinds? Any of you who use white paper to take notes on this little talk know that you're using paper that is acid's been used to turn that wood pulp white. And we know that you can use fungi much more efficiently and without the acid runoff. There should be a little note at the bottom of all the paper saying, this paper was produced using fungi. Maybe that's something for the future.
The point of the Telluride Mushroom Festival is always our parade down Colorado Avenue, Telluride's Main Street. And like mushrooms, we love the rain. So you know what? We hope it rains at our parade.
Men, women, and children dressed like mushrooms and fairies. It's yeah. Wonderful.
Second year for the costume, seventh year for the parade, festival, whatever.
Larry, who did you dress up as today?
I'm gonna go incognito.
Do you believe in magic? In a young girl's heart, how the music can free her whenever it starts, and it's magic if the music is good. I'll tell you about the magic and the free of soul, but it's like trying to tell a stranger about a rock and roll. Believe in magic, don't bother to choose if it's jug band music or rhythm and blues. Just go and listen, it'll start with a smile that won't wipe off your face, no matter how hard you try. Feet start tapping and you can't seem to find how you got there, so just blow your mind.
Larry,
ah,
come on, get your ass up. We gotta go.
All right, all right.
I got you some coffee.
Oh, all right. Yum.
So how'd you sleep?
Oh, the mushrooms kept me up.
Yeah, well, not surprised to hear that.
Pesky mushrooms.
I've been a mushroom gypsy for years now. I go from one place to another looking for mushrooms, chasing the rain, as Taylor would say, following the precipitation events from Alaska and then moving down the coast through Oregon and Washington. And after winter, January rolls around, it's time to go south of the border. I end up down in Mexico, Ecuador, Costa Rica, wherever the mushrooms are. And it's great. It's a great life.
Um,
Mushroom Festival ended this past weekend. According to organizers, a record number of mushrooms attended this year's festival.
Weekend update.
Coming up Labor Day, our annual Film Buff Buffet, the Telluride Film Festival. Opening night's film is the world premiere of Know Your Mushrooms. You mushroom people won't want to miss that.
Unusual mushrooms, lacking gills or any other exterior spore-producing structures. They produce their spores internally and then release them in astronomical numbers. Carried by the wind, clusters of puffballs are known to travel hundreds of miles, with spores exploding in every direction each time the puffball hits the ground.
One of the things that irks me most about biology is that when you look at any college biology textbook, it's about 1,200 pages on average. The amount of room given to fungi or mushrooms is 20 pages. 20 pages out of 1,200. How could that be? I mean, who's in charge? And why aren't they up to date with what we know about the interaction between plants and mushrooms? Why can't they get it together and realize that this is, it's not just a 20-page additional section that could just as easily be excluded, but it's a terribly important part, and that's one area where, you know, we're failing the next generation if we don't give them that kind of information. And Telluride, that's one of the reasons we're here, is to promote this.
Now you showed me others.
space is full of them. And there isn't anything I can do. Believe.